The Cthulhu mythos is full of things which seemingly threaten the entire Earth. But how many of these threats actually deliver? The fungi from Yuggoth tell Dr. Wilmarth, "We could easily wipe out humanity, but it's too much trouble." Is this just posturing? Maybe. On the other hand, the United States, during the Vietnam War, could obviously have easily wiped out North Vietnam, but that would have been a lot of trouble. This, added to our own internal divisions, meant that in fact, though we had the physical capability, we did not really have the power to wipe out North Vietnam. Perhaps this is also true of the fungi. There must be brain fungi back on Yuggoth saying, "I don't want to spend $1 trillion or whatever they use for their economic analysis on wiping out the humans. Forget it. We'll just pull out and get our Blue John somewhere else." How about Cthulhu? He's on record as planning to destroy humanity. Humanity, that is, not all Earth life. Cthulhu ruled vast parts of Earth before, and yet Earth life survived. Humanity might even survive in the form of cultists under Cthulhu's tutelage, though vastly reduced in power and numbers. Yogg-Sothoth is a more existential threat. In the Dunwich Horror, it's clear that not only will the Earth be cleared off, but the actual geometry and natural laws of our planet will be changed. So yeah, Yogg-Sothoth would change everything forever, leaving an inexplicable, unknowable Earth, except in the text, it also says that Yogg-Sothoth once did rule on Earth. Yet, obviously, life carried on after Yogg-Sothoth's time, because here we are! I am here to discuss the one threat that we know for a fact could have wiped out all life on Earth. Something deadlier than the fungi, than Cthulhu or Yogg-Sothoth. The flying polyps. They arrived near the end of the Permian Age and immediately began to prey on Earth life. They were the cause of the Permian extinction. This was the closest Earth came to being completely wiped out. 96% of species on Earth died out. Now that seems like a lot, but let me explain just how lethal this actually was. Let us say that you, in your head, decided that you hate dogs.
Who doesn't, right?
And you want to make dogs go extinct. And also assume there's no humans breeding dogs, keeping them safe. Just dogs as they live now. Okay? So, let's see. If you destroyed 96% of all the dogs in America, how long would it be before we back to a solid dog population, right? A year? 2 years? It wouldn't take long to bounce back. If you killed 96 out of 100 dogs, there's plenty of dogs to reestablish as many dogs as you had before. So, you got to kill more than 96%. What if you destroyed all but 1 in 1,000 dogs? Then would that remaining remnant be able to make new dogs? And the answer is, yeah, easy. I mean, they can find each other. They would howl. They could smell each other out. There'd be plenty of dogs again. So, okay, what about 1 in 10,000 dogs? We're probably getting closer, but realistically, to wipe out all the dogs and make sure we didn't have any more dogs left might be more like 1 out of 100,000, 1 out of 50,000, some huge number of destruction. So you see, and that would give us a 96% chance, say, killing all but 1 in 50,000 dogs of wiping out dogs. When 96% of Earth's species die out, that's what's happening. It's not that 96% of Earth life dies. It's that one creature in 50,000 maybe survived. And that gave each of those species a 4% chance of going on. We were very close to vanishing altogether from the Earth. Okay? Now, before everything was destroyed by the flying polyps, the tiny remnants of the Yithians got taken over by the actual Yithians, and with their super technology, they managed to drive the polyps underground and save the planet. My guess is this was not a trivial thing that just happened overnight, but it was a really hard-fought war. And anyway, the polyps weren't dead. They were only marginalized. They emerged again at the end of the Cretaceous. Now, this was not as major an extinction as the Permian. It's a lot more famous because it included the dinosaurs, but, you know, it also included the Yithians, which was the polyps' goal. Let me talk about how bad the devastation was at the end of the Cretaceous, the dinosaur extinction. So there's two kinds of fossils that we have throughout ancient times of shelled octopus-like animals. One are the nautiluses and one are the ammonites. They look kind of similar. They both have a curly shell with an octopus thing. Well, we assume an octopus thing. We don't really have fossils of the soft parts. They look kind of similar, but there's a lot of differences between these things internally. Now, the ammonites were super, super successful. There was thousands of types of ammonites. They lived in the bottom of the water, on the surface, everywhere. The universe was full of ammonites. There was animals like mosasaurs who specialized in just eating ammonites. It was a big deal. Nautiluses, not so much. There was a few nautiluses around here and there. You still find them. Nautiluses are still around today, you know, but there's only a few species of them. They're a rare thing. So the question is, when the extinction happened, how come the not-so-common, not-so-effective nautiluses survived and the vastly successful ammonites died out? Well, it's very simple. We know why this was, because the ammonites, the way they reproduce is they lay thousands of tiny little eggs that immediately hatched into larval ammonites, started growing the shells, and then they went on. A lot of things do this. Lots of tiny eggs. Nautiluses lay great big grape-sized eggs that sit around doing nothing for a year or more before they hatch into a nautilus about this big, then they keep growing larger, become a full one. So probably what happened is it wasn't that the extinction killed the ammonites and not the nautiluses. Probably what happened is the Cretaceous extinction killed all the nautiluses and all the ammonites, and then while the effect was still going on, the tiny ammonite eggs hatched, and they died, and the nautilus eggs sat around for a year until the effects had gotten lessened, then they hatched, and they survived. So it wasn't a matter, so in other words, everything was being killed. Now, so even this lesser outbreak of the flying polyps was really, really nasty. Now, I know there was a giant meteor too. I'm not saying there wasn't a giant meteor. There was clearly a giant meteor, but perhaps the polyps, who came from space, had something to do with that, too. And we also know that the polyps are still around on Earth in our current time, from the story The Shadow Out of Time. In fact, I surmise that the Pleistocene extinction could have been caused by a minor polyp uprising. Some recent studies have indicated that the death of the megafauna was, in fact, not due to human hunting. There's a lot of evidence for this now. Perhaps some primitive human accidentally probed too deep into a cave system, they came out and they started wiping out things. Well, so these polyps nearly wiped us all out in the Permian, in the Cretaceous, and had a stab at it in the Pleistocene. But what are flying polyps, and what do they look like? Well, Lovecraft calls them polyps. In his time period, the word polyp meant a tentacled being, like an octopus or a jellyfish or a sea anemone. My daughter once asked me, what are they the enemies of? But that was hard to explain, and the like. So we can safely assume the polyps had tentacles. Lovecraft also says that they were not always visible, and that parts of their bodies lapse in and out of visibility, which implies that they are fourth dimensional, perhaps, moving in and out of Earth's phase, or that their body was affected by electromagnetic forces different ways, probably under the polyps' control. They might be able to use this ability to emit gamma rays or other less well-known energies. Now, they're often portrayed as formless, but Lovecraft doesn't actually say they are shapeshifters like Cthulhu. They may have rather malleable and variable shapes, though, like octopus or jellyfish. Oddly enough, Lovecraft says the polyps have feet. They leave tracks when they move around on the ground. The tracks are kind of odd. They're large, but each track has five closely grouped pins, something like toes, so they can walk on the ground. Of course, they can fly. It's in their name, right? They have control over wind, which is preternatural. Now, in the story, they say this wind seems to suck at the prey. To me, this sounds like some effect of static electricity. Now, this is a real thing. In 1980, a 3M plant was making plastic film. And, of course, when you make lots of plastic film at extreme rate going out, you know, static electricity can build up on a dry day, and it did. It produced such a strong field that people on the floor below the film couldn't walk through the field. In fact, if you were in the field, you couldn't turn left or right. You had to walk backwards to get out of it. David Swenson, who described this, says he saw insects caught in it that couldn't control their movement, and he thought it would have the same effect on birds, which seems likely to me. So the sucking, paralyzing effect could have been static electricity. We also know something that maybe either backs this up or maybe torpedoes it, is that the polyps were vulnerable to electrical weapons, which is how the Ithians defeated them. What if the polyps were making electricity? It might seem odd that the Ithian electrical guns could hurt the electrical polyps, but maybe the Ithians emitted electricity on this exact same wavelength that the polyps used and somehow confused their senses. Or maybe the polyps aren't using electricity, but something else, and I'm wrong. Oh, one more thing. Why do we call them flying polyps instead of some other name? Well, they're recorded in the Nahadic manuscripts, which the Ithians wrote. which is written in the Ithian tongue, and it's not a pronounceable language because the Ithians didn't have vocal cords and they didn't communicate with vocal cords. They clicked their claws to talk. They must have done so extremely quickly because they were amazingly smart. Watch this. Of course, super fast clicking is certainly possible. Even humans can do it. So the Ithians called flying polyps probably by a series of staccato snapping noises, almost like Morse code. But you know what? This video isn't about the Ithians, so let's end here. Watch out for the polyps, the real menace.